Well, I'm painting over a picture that I finished earlier this year that I didn't like after I'd finished it, and I put a pale blue wash over it. So you can see the picture there still. My idea is to paint this new still life across it. I like this subject because of the colour, obviously. And the idea is just quickly to brush in the composition. You don't have to be too accurate here. The screen partitions help to give you guidelines. Once you've got a rough idea, you can start just putting in some shadows. I tend to work all over a picture at the start, just to get everything in. You've got to get the composition so there's a nice balance. Paint goes on quite easily over the old colour. The brightest thing in the painting will be the lip of that reflection there on the middle edge. So if I just isolate that with some white now, I can come back to it later. I know that everything around it's got to be a lower tone. Painting this reflective surfaces. Okay, so just painting what you see. Now I got that far. Now do a bit of the background. You normally find there's one little corner that you can get your teeth into. And that looks like it's around here. Then when you can establish a little bit, the rest leads on from it. There are times when you know what you want to paint, but you just can't get it. That's the most annoying aspect. Portraits especially. You miss something in the face and you've been staring at them for hours. You know it's wrong. I think the picture I've just covered up was a picture that I knew fairly early on that it wasn't what I liked, but I continued with it. And I should have learnt the lesson. Just stop. Start again. I like the quail's eggs in this. I painted a lot of eggs. And that gives a sort of anchor to the picture there. Then you've got the line of the box underneath. And that handle over there. So you start picking up little bits. At the moment, it's just a case of covering the old picture, so I'm not really worried about accuracy or colour. I was once working at a place called Art in Action in Oxford, where you you set up a subject to paint, and then over 4 days, up to 20,000 people turn up and walk around the event. And I had a big crowd about around me in 1 day, and a bloke at the back said, I was painting some silver, a silver jug, and this man pushed through to the front and said, how did you paint that silver? I said, and I pointed down to the colours on my palette. He said, no, you didn't. You used silver paint. I said, I didn't. He said, you did. I said, I didn't. Look, I just used the colours there. And he kept going on and on. And in the end, I just said, all right, you win. I used silver paint. And he went away real smug and happy, to the amusement of everyone else around me. But he was convinced I couldn't paint silver without using a tube of silver paint. So for the sake of this picture, I'm using Brasso. If you approach it in the right way and don't try and think of silver as you're painting it, just paint what you see. And that way you get the reflections. A bit like this, you know, the more I look at this, I can see the shadows of the reflections, sorry, of the quail's eggs in the pot. Then you come round here, you see. And if you, the more you look, the more you see, and you get the reflection of the moss. In there, you see. And the reflection of the moss in there. So slowly you start breaking up the surface that you're painting. You've got to concentrate on the one thing that will go first. And in this still life, the first thing that will go is the flowers. So you've got to make an effort to get them in. Painting now has been going for a couple of weeks, but I haven't been working on it for that period, just off and on. But there comes a point in any painting where you have to start coming to conclusions and knowing the limit of your ability, and there's a certain finite line that you reach, and you know you can't progress any further, even though you admire the work of so many others and you marvel at their skills. You've got to be honest to yourself always. I suppose being at Camberwell first and then at the Royal Academy schools, it was at a time where you were allowed to sit and observe and not have some tutor on your ear suggesting something else. The teachers at Camberwell and the Royal Academy schools were all representational artists, or the ones that taught me, and it was all down to patient observation and trying to be honest in your approach. When I was at the Royal Academy schools, the art critic Brian Saul bought one of my earliest self-portraits, and he always had that painting. He never showed it on. And when he died a couple of years ago, his friend and partner gave it back to me, which was rather lovely. Brian had said he'd like me to have it. But Brian was always very nice and kind to me. We used to exchange letters, and he'd ring me and talk about things. He was very sweet about my painting. He was never cruel in any way, although he came across like that in his interviews and articles. He always tried to look on the positive side, in my opinion anyway. There were those that loathed the very sound of his name. I remember once when I'd been very ill, I met him in Wimbledon, and there couldn't have been a sweeter man. He did a lovely write-up for me in an exhibition. My wife Carol took a bunch of flowers around to him as a thank you. And he looked at them and said, "Oh, they're almost edible." It was rather lovely. Finishing off a painting is a balancing act. You've got so familiar with the picture that you look across it, and all your searching out is the highlights, soft lights, and focus. This is an unusual one for me, because the focus of it isn't specific to one area. Perhaps just in the reflections I'm seeing a focal point, but you mustn't overdo that aspect of the painting, i.e. you mustn't gild the lily, because you can blow it out of the water then. But that's the joy of looking at a subject in front of you, as opposed to the slavish rendering of a photograph. When you're painting portraits, their mood changes, but you might not actually be aware of it totally, but it's happening in your picture. Little nuances of likeness. But coming back to the photograph, if you've got a photograph, you're slavishly copying that. There's only a few artists I know who are brilliant at interpreting photographs, whereas all my life I've just been looking at things and I can't change. An artist friend once said to me, while you're looking, you're absorbing the subject. It might not be there on the canvas, but it's there in your memory. And it will come back to help you. I'd love to get more people to sit for me. But alas, people can't give you the time these days. As I'm looking at this picture now, I'm so sensitive to what I've been looking at, I can see where certain colours just jump out slightly and I knock them back. And it's almost going back to this balancing act. You touch one area of a picture and you suddenly see it triggers off a reaction in another corner. I was just working under there, and now I can see in the moss. I've got to do something down there. And that's what happens in portraiture. You can be working on one aspect of the face, and the mood a change, or a smile across the face, and it will, and you'll follow it if you're observant, and that will trigger all sorts of other things in the face, and then it's almost like going up and down a hill. You get to the top, you do something, and down you go again, chasing something else. I guess that's been a good way of describing a painting. You've got to stop when you're at the crest of a hill before you cascade down into a slump again. There have been some moments in this painting where I thought, should I add something else? And then, that would be gilding the lily in a way. It wouldn't help it much. My colours are much the same as when I was a student. Again, over the years I've tried to change. But they're the colours that I go back to all the time. Green is an oxide of a chromium. I tend to use that in conjunction with viridian. They both have a certain distinct function, but I never use them together. Portraiture is slightly different. You can think you're on a winning streak with one and then walk away from it and think, and you, lose it for some reason. It was there 1 minute and then you lose it. Could be a brush stroke, working too close to the picture, thinking too much of the picture and not of the subject. One artist, I can't remember who he was, another teacher. So there's a moment in any picture where the subject takes over. Not the subject, the picture. Let me get this right. The painting takes over from the subject. In other words, what you've got in front of you has got to get in front of what you're looking at. Because you reach a certain point in the picture and you start to fiddle. And no matter how many brush strokes you put on it, you're never going to change it. It's a bit like when you're painting, going back to portraiture, when you start a portrait, if it's not satisfying in the first hour, the composition, the feeling of it, if that isn't right in the first hour, no matter how much work you put into it, you'll never improve that initial moment. So often in the past I started a portrait and thought the contrary and thinking, oh, I'll dig my way out of this problem. You don't. It saves you hours of work just stopping and starting on a completely fresh canvas. Don't have the image showing in the picture that you rubbed out. Get it completely clean and start again. You'll always find something better. Now I think I'm going to say this is finished now. And I'm going to come to that moment that I sign the picture. The J needs a little bit of tweaking. That's it. Okay. So that's finished, folks. I'm quite pleased with that one. It's unusual for me, and it's a busy little picture, but I'm very pleased with it. Thank you. this is a subject that I've been wanting to paint for the winter. It's dry enough now. So it's a case of working as well as you can. The dogs are working around me somewhere, digging holes. There's a little group of daffodils I planted in the autumn, just above the bonfire. And at some point I want to paint those. I like to make something out of nothing, really. I've never been a scene painter. I've always fallen on my face when I've painted scenes. It gives me a sigh. I wouldn't mind actually having a figure, probably Carol, walking down there to the fire. But that's something I'll add later. The background I can work on next week. This is a magnificent scene near sunset. You get a lovely golden glow through there. So now just there. I like the idea of that pitchfork just sitting there. There's a lovely passage through here. The painting's got to a stage now where I'm really enjoying it. So though you're opening a little window, some of my paintings, if I can't finish within a set period, I leave to next year and come back to the same subject again. I painted some snowdrops last year, and when I looked at the painting I realised it was far too mannered, it was too static. There's a temptation to do too much on one sitting. Sign, or what was the word? I can't think of the word. Gives you a point to stop for the day on a certain picture. If it burnt till midnight, I'll probably stand here till midnight painting it. But it's going to die fairly soon. I started 2 weeks ago with Matt and Richard. So, temptation to add a bit too much. As I say, my main concern is that relationship, that balance between light and dark. I've got the figure in, which is my wife Carol, walking down as a focal point, carrying some sticks for the fire. Mister, my dog, one of my dogs, is in the foreground only because he did sit there for half an hour the other day. I couldn't resist painting him. The sky is very blue today. Tempted just to knock it back a bit. Just up the top there. It's got to be darker than that. Too dark, too blue, too blue. Just trying to put a bit of this cloud in. Just seems to jump well with the fire. Well, I haven't got on today because I'm quite happy with the fire. And a bonfire is something that you light, and it's totally different from the last one. Mister! I've got a dog here that's digging up the landscape as I'm painting it. When you start painting things, you invariably paint them too big. And it's a case of refining things down. Just tempted to put a bit more smoke. Do the smoke, I need to glaze it a bit. Just and then I'm adding a little bit more oil to the paint just for this glaze, this smoke. At the moment I'm concentrating on the top half of the picture because that's in the light that I want. Shadows haven't cast themselves yet. Thank you. my imaginary Carol. I'm just going to work a bit on her. Just Mister, don't. This is lovely through there, the light. Couldn't have a more perfect day. Well, probably could have a more perfect day if I was painting a bit better. That's too. You keep spotting things when you're out in nature. This tree here, this silver birch, is looking a bit too bold. I want to knock him back a bit. There's a lovely sapling just here as well. I can get him. Some things seem so insignificant when you're looking at the landscape in the initial stages, but they quietly come into view. Quietly saying, I want to be in the picture. Getting close now. Getting close to completion now. Or as much as I want to do to it. I reckon I'm about there now. I think I've done all I can do at the moment. No, I think I'm about there, so I'll call that a day. Whoops. I always remember painting the grandchildren, and I'd say, okay, nearly finished. Let's just one more minute. And they would go, no, not one more minute, because one more minute of you is 1 hour. 1 hour, you. I'd always go on and on. They'd never believe me. Okay, I'm finished. I'm going to sign it. Marking the end of it. There we go. Finished.